Initiating system 1.
The drama really means nothing to me. I ride by and blow your brains out. It's no time to cock it. No way you can stop it when niggas run up on you with them things out. I do what I gotta do. I don't care if I get caught. The DA could play this motherfucking tape in court.
Perhaps just as scarily, gangs also form alliances between one another. This typically means that gangs are friendly with each other, and they will help each other out both financially and backing each other up in fights. As it stands at this time, the Vagos, the Families, the Ballers, Bikers, so on, they aren't on very good terms with one another, and there's a good chance that they will come into conflict with one another. The reason why all gangs fight one another is simply because of their respective alliances or their particular stances. Now, a good example of a good alliance would be the Mexican cartel and the Vagos. Now, because of this, gangs, they don't fight one another for the most part. If the Vagos, and let's say the Aztecas, get into a major beef, they're going to have to deal with the Mexican cartel. However, gangs like the Families and Ballers, they work independently. Although sometimes they may work together, but for the most part, they work independently. Now, some gangs may have a close relationship with motorcycle clubs, which that's very common because, you know, in cases where motorcycle clubs, they have drugs to distribute or they can manufacture drugs, gangs often are a good way to distribute said drugs. So having that relationship works very well. A good example would be, say, the Resurrected Saints. They're really good at manufacturing cocaine, and so by manufacturing cocaine, they can then exchange with the Ballers, who can now distribute said cocaine and then also turn a profit from it. So the Ballers would financially be bankrolling the Resurrected Saints, whereas the Saints are providing the product to the Ballers. Now, it's all in best interest that they stay on friendly terms with one another. Additionally, motorcycle clubs, which, you know, in cases like this, they sometimes have alleged ties with the mafias and other cartels. And for them to kind of maintain their business, they have to keep some type of level of camaraderie there. If that sounds a little bit complicated, don't worry. It is complicated, because how can these gangs fight one another and then also work together? However, the complicated string of relationships means that over the course of years, that all major street gangs have remained on at least some type of good terms with one another or with another gang. And, you know, if that relationship is threatened, then in some cases, then, you know, they may sacrifice a member, or, you know, they will try to kind of pay some type of homage to one another. Now, let's say that a Baller gang member is killed by a Families gang member, then that will kind of start up another feud, which then also larger players may also get drawn into. When it comes to gang activities, you know, gangs still, they see each other as rivals for the most part. So even though they may, let's say for example, one gang may rep one set and another gang may represent another set, they still do things together, such as drag racing. A lot of times, you know, motorcycle clubs, they have racing, street racing. Sometimes they may race on a private track, and sometimes they have something that's called Fight Club. Fight Club is a very interesting phenomenon where gang members will literally get into a fist fight with one another and beat each other to a pulp. And of course, sometimes, you know, there's prizes or some type of things to incentivize, you know, these type of activities. But ultimately, these are more so community building activities. From what we've seen, gang members often open up to racing other gangs because it's not extremely hostile. And, you know, especially gangs that don't have like a kill on sight relationship, However, in such situations, you know, races can turn hostile. Of course, you know, any type of competition can turn hostile, especially when you're dealing with, you know, rival gangs and things of that nature. Sometimes organizations who may lose may accuse the winners of foul play, and then that kind of sparks a whole debacle there. However, more organized street races, and not just impromptu street races, are usually arranged prior to the race and gives a little bit of notice so they can kind of be a little bit more organized, a little bit more set up. Now, during our time in Los Santos, we haven't really seen a street race turn violent. However, they do. And also, just like there's bikers, there are people in Los Santos that dedicate themselves to just street racing, and that's something that we'll cover a little bit later on and maybe another episode. Now, a lot of times when it comes to these street races, you know, there's bets that are being placed. Normally a gang or a set will kind of organize a race and then have other people RSVP for those races, kind of get everybody in, and then they'll set like maybe an entry fee or things of that nature. Now, in some cases, you know, regardless of whether or not the organization that's hosting the event, they may take like a temporary cut from all the action that's being thrown around. Give me a second here. Now, it's very rare that you'll see something like, you know, rapping or anything like that. But there's some communities that does do like, you know, like freestyle challenges and things of that nature. Outside of the main three, we have mostly street races, fight clubs, and you know, there is even times where, you know, gangs may challenge one another to like small skirmishes and things of that nature. So with all this talk about gangs, one of the most fascinating things about gangs is how they're organized. When it comes to street gangs, they have their own organizational structures, whereas some street gangs, such as the Vagos, are very, very organized, while others, they're a lot loose, such as the Families and the Ballers. Because of this, it's very difficult to give an accurate insight on the structure of a street gang, but for the most part, there's always some structure there. Now, there's always some type of universal talk or some type of universal structure that all gangs work on. So first and foremost, we have the OG. The OG, that's the original gangsters. Now, original gangsters, those are people that's kind of considered as extremely dangerous. And, you know, when it comes to becoming an OG, that means you survive the gang a lot longer than, you survive the game a lot longer than you were expected to, because realistically your life expectancy while running with these gangs or running in this lifestyle is pretty low. These are people that hit like a certain age while still banging. Now there's different reference systems, you know, that people use, such as, you know, people who's been just recently initiated, those are the baby gangsters or BGs. People who been in a gang, you know, for quite some time, those are kind of known as just G's, you know. And those who survived the gang for a lot longer, those are your OGs. These systems came into place back in the late 80s, and you still see those prevalent today. Now, the OGs are kind of the people that you kind of see lounging around, hanging around, who have a lot of respect but very little responsibilities. You know, as far as with generating income, things of that nature, they still get cuts and percentages, but they don't have to do as much work as some of the baby gangsters or the gangsters for the most part. Now, when it comes to gangs such as the Vagos, they are very, very, very organized. And the reason for it is because although on a surface level, they are a street gang, they act a lot like a mafia would as well in some regards. So at the top of the Vagos food chain, you have their leader. Now, their leader is often overseas, and he sees the action from somewhere completely remote. And on top of all the action, on top of all the income, you know, he always rules from the top. Now, the Vagos leaders normally working for the Don or some type of boss, mob boss for the Mexican cartel. So normally the Vagos is just a extension of the cartel that's kind of operating under a different name for the most part. Whereas the cartel is normally across the border, the street gang kind of operates within the border. So, typically within the Vargos, you have capos and kind of how those type things work in a mafia background in another episode. Now, Vargos, they started working as direct muscles for the Mexican cartel, and now they're kind of like runners for the Mexican cartel because they are able to distribute so much product, and that's where a huge portion of their income stateside comes from, the Vargos. Now, typically when you have Vargos, they have like five elders who oversee different aspects of the gang, and they run it accordingly. Now, because of this, that means that the Vargos, they kind of answer to five key people, and then on top of those five key people, there's one guy who answers to the Mexican cartel overall. Now, because of this, there's a lot of secrecy. There is a lot of kind of militaristic, as far as with rankings, orders being passed down from one person to the next to get a certain task accomplished. Now, when it comes to those foreign relations, the elder gang member is, for the most part, responsible for overseeing and maintaining relations between the Vargos and other organizations. They're also responsible for maintaining relations with the Vargos, the gang themselves, and the Mexican cartel. However, the Mexican cartel, they wouldn't deal with, say, street level, or I would say the OGs, G's, and the baby